This is an exciting time of the year with prom being tomorrow and graduation right around the corner. But with all the excitement, we forget the simple things like driving distracted. We ask you not to text and drive, stay off Snapchat while you are driving. When you get behind that wheel, concentrate on driving. It could save a life. Texting while driving causes 330,000 injuries per year. Did you know that texting and driving is the same as driving after drinking 4 beers? We want to see everyone at prom and graduation. No one likes going to funerals, so drive smart. Texting drivers takes their eyes off the road on an average of 4.6 seconds. At 55 miles an hour, that's like driving the length of a football field with your eyes closed. Now, with that being said, we asked you to arrive alive. This presentation is a collaborative effort from YOSA, Advisor Deputy Underwood, Shawsville Rescue Squad, Ellison Fire Department, Montgomery County Sheriff's Department, Regina State Police, New River Valley Driving School, Warren Funeral Services, Carillion Lifeguard, All Call Tap Towing, Mrs. Mary Pettit, Commonwealth's Attorney, Nourishes the Pride by Montgomery Emergency Services, Neil Turner and Sherry Blevins.
I just saw a truck flip on Banner's Run.
How many people's injured? Can you tell?
I saw somebody fly out of the car.
Someone was ejected from the vehicle?
Yes.
Can you tell me anything else about injuries?
I see someone laying on the ground to my right now.
Okay, so we know there's at least two there. Any
yes.
more you can see?
No.
Any more vehicles other than the pickup truck?
No, they flipped into a river.
Into a river?
Yes.
Is it still on its top or on its side?
On its side.
Okay, can you tell me anything else about it? I'm going to go ahead and sit by and let you respond to it.
No, that's all I see.
Okay, let me know back if you see anything else, all right?
All right.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Montgomery County.
Montgomery 25. 25, need you to respond. Single vehicle accident, possible ejections, motors run. Montgomery County, Shawsville Rescue, Ellison Fire, respond to a single vehicle accident, possible ejections, Boners Run Road.
Thank you. buddy, you
what
okay?
I do?
You okay?
I'm sorry.
What happened?
I don't know.
I
just need to call my mom or
stay right
I need
here.
To call
here. Just,
talk
no, just sit down right there. Sit down right there.
Still hurt for Montgomery Tail Rescue to expedite. We've got one 1033 and one code for it. Anybody else in there?
10-4 copy, 1033. Montgomery County Shelter Rescue. Deputy on scene advises 1033.
What happened?
One code gray. Repeat, 1033, one code gray.
I just got a text and I just went to look at it for a second.
Who are they at? Why are they laying out here? Okay.
Shelter 76 in Montgomery. Can you go ahead and dispatch lifeguard, please?
No, just
Temple.
Couple. My turn. We're going to take care of him. Take a look at you and make sure you're okay. Where's your phone at, Dakota?
It's right here.
Can I see?
Yes, sir.
I'm just going to put it right here, okay? Okay, folks, what you see happening right now, fire and rescue coming on scene. They're doing assessments to the patients that are on the ground. And once they make that assessment, then they'll begin to immobilize the patients and prepare them for transport. I'm just been advised that the patient where the trooper is at is a fatality. Okay, Beth with Shawville Rescue Squad, if you could tell us, what are they doing with the long blue board and this patient that they're working on now?
This patient was ejected from the vehicle going at a substantial amount of speed, so they're going to go ahead and treat his injuries and place a C-collar around his neck, which will keep his cervical spine secure in case he were to have a spine injury, and they'll go ahead and place him on the backboard and secure him on that to keep any other injuries from further injuring himself.
Okay, and then once he's on the board, they've done the collar to keep his neck in line. Then what will happen from there? What will they do with this individual?
This individual is going to be flown by a lifeguard because his injuries are too serious for us to transport by ground, and he needs to have immediate medical attention. So they're going to go ahead and fly this patient with lifeguard.
One of the things to understand, if you'll hear lifeguard is in the area, is that his time expected to be in the operating room from here would be about 10 minutes. If he were to go by ground, that time would probably extend to 30 to 40 minutes, even possibly longer than 1 hour. Now, what are they doing with the other patient over here with the sheet? Yeah.
They are covering this patient up because she was already dead when we got on scene, and I believe the funeral home will come and take her.
Beth, what are some of the reasons, or what are some of the injuries that you, as the incident commander of this event, that you would see that would indicate a need to call for the helicopter?
Based on the fact that they were going, I believe, around 60 miles an hour, and he was thrown from the vehicle, he was not secured. He could have a head injury. It appeared to me that his organs were hanging out of his abdomen. He has multiple injuries that they're going to want to be treated immediately. Beth, could you explain to us why lifeguard is not called out on all car accidents? Most car accidents, you find people are actually wearing their seatbelt, and when they wear their seatbelt, their injuries are significantly not as critical as this patient. Not every patient that has a car accident needs to be flown by lifeguard. Only those that are extremely in critical condition need to be flown. Where would they go to? What hospital? Lifeguard ultimately makes the choice, but this patient will most likely go to Roanoke Memorial Hospital.
Ladies and gentlemen, as lifeguard lands, please hold your caps. Please hold your caps and anything that loose items. Okay, Beth, I see one of the rescue workers with the driver. What could we assume is going on with him?
It appears that they're just checking to make sure his injuries are not life-threatening or that he would need to go to the hospital right now.
Okay, the most critical patient has now been transported to Roanoke Memorial Hospital. The one individual who died in the crash is being attended to, waiting on the funeral home to come and remove that body. The other fatality was on top of the car. They're covered by a sheet. And at this point, the crash team will be given some information about how they reconstruct the accident and why.
She's going to explain and walk us through the possible charges and consequences. We know that Deputy Schrader has placed him under, charged him with reckless driving, but there could be other pending charges for the fatality and maiming.
So he's already been charged with reckless driving. That's probably about the least of his concerns at this point.
Reckless driving is a misdemeanor. It could carry up to 1 year in jail and a fine. The bigger issue here is we have a fatality. So in all likelihood, it's going to be charged with an involuntary manslaughter out of that. Based on the texting and driving or otherwise being distracted and reckless in that driving, and it results in a death. So what happens then? Well, he would be facing up to 10 years in prison, indefinite loss of driver's license. To kind of give you an example of a couple of local cases, there was a case in Blacksburg, which is now about 8 to 10 years ago, where somebody was texting. She had also been consuming alcohol, ran up on a sidewalk, and ended up injuring 8 people. She still does not have a driver's license. She's been released from jail, but the judge has refused to give her a driver's license back. So obviously, even as a college student, it has affected her ability to get a job for many, many years. Second case that we had just recently was a New River Community College student, and he offered to drive 4 people home from a party and decided to show off a little bit and tell them about racing on the back roads of Montgomery County. He ended up with one young lady dying and one being trapped in a car for hours beside her friend who was dead. He had a jury trial, was found guilty, and the jury recommended that he spend the next 9 years in prison.
Will there be a difference if he's a juvenile charged instead of an adult?
There are some differences, but basically if you are a juvenile and you have been given the privilege to operate a motor vehicle, we expect you to act like an adult. So you may not end up with quite the amount of time in jail. It probably depends on how old you are and whether you have any kind of prior records, but if you're going to be driving a car, you better be expected to have the same consequences as an adult.
Does that happen?
What's your number of names? Sorry to tell you, but...
No! Is Michael okay? What about Dakota?
I'm not sure.
Who What caused this? What type of evidence would they collect to use, and how long would the trial procedures take?
Usually for a felony charge, it would be about a year to a year and a half from when the time of the offense was until we would be done with the trial. The crash team does a lot of the work in these type of cases. Obviously, you know, law enforcement would be looking to see if there were drugs or alcohol involved. There might be blood or breath tests involved there. We also might be obtaining search warrants to get electronic records to kind of tell about the texting or phone calls and what was going on with that. There would be collection of evidence from any witnesses, both those who would be in the car and then just other observers. And so that would be the primary evidence collection and things. You might be held in jail for that year, year and a half awaiting trial, or you might be released on bond. It just depends on the circumstances.
And your experience with the community, I mean, obviously this is a tragedy and everyone loses, even the driver. victims are, do they get to have victim witness impact statements or character statements for the defendant?
Both sides are going to get to present evidence, so the defendant would be able at sentencing to present some evidence about their character and what sort of a citizen they have been up to this point. And I will say that most of the time these are people where they don't have a prior criminal record. The young man that I just mentioned that got the 9-year sentence, he's 24 years old and he doesn't really have any prior criminal history. The victim's families would also be able to give impact statements and testimony in court, as well as people who may have been injured or witnessed it and are impacted by the loss of a friend or by injuries that they received.
So what is the procedure after he is arrested to go to the magistrate, a bond? What are the next steps for the defendant?
Okay, so the police officer is able to do the arrest right here, and then the next stop would be at the magistrate's office, and the officer would be presenting evidence as far as the facts as they were aware of them at that time. The magistrate would decide what charges were going to be issued, and then the stop after that would be at the jail, and they'd be processed into a jail facility. And that's assuming that the magistrate doesn't say that they should have a bond. And in this particular situation with a fatality, probably the magistrate is not going to grant a bond. They're probably going to hold somebody. So you can kind of count on sitting in jail for a while until you're able to go before the judge in the next day or two. And then it would be up to the judge whether or not to grant a bond. And a bond is an amount of money to make sure that you're going to appear for court and for trial. And sometimes it is a lot of money, and the judge can also say that no bond is going to be sufficient to make sure that you show up. It can mean if you're going to pay money that you have to pay a bondsman, you don't get that money back. It could also mean that your parents are putting up their house to make sure that you're going to be a good behavior and are going to come to court and go through the proceedings like you're now required to.
In addition to the criminal charges, I'm sure there will be civil lawsuits as well.
I would absolutely expect that. We all have car insurance for a reason, but if you are doing something intentionally, your car insurance may or may not pay out for that. And in addition, your insurance only covers whatever amount your insurance is for. So when you have somebody that has long-term injuries, or you have a death and you have sort of a loss of their prospective income and what they were going to do, we could be talking millions of dollars. And even if your insurance covers part of that, you're still going to be liable for the rest of it. You may be paying on that for the rest of your life.
We don't know the age of the driver, but I know this from the scene that they were some people riding in the back of the pickup truck. Just going over teenage curfew, passenger restriction laws, the laws about riding in the bed of a pickup truck. You have to be at least 16 to ride in the bed of a pickup truck. And for a first-time driver, for the first year under age 18, they're only allowed to have one other passenger under the age of 21 in the car, unless it's parent, legal guardians in the front seat with them. After their first year of driving, then they're still not age 18. State of Virginia will allow them to have up to 3 passengers under the age of 18. Under the age of 21, only driving them to and from school or school-sponsored activity. So there could be a possible pending charges if this driver was a minor and he has some passenger restrictions laws violated there, correct?
That's true, and I guess I see a lot of, having a daughter who is recently licensed and lots of friends who are getting their license, I see a lot of parents who are not very familiar with that, and I think it's the student's responsibility to make sure that your parents are aware of what the laws are. So, for example, if you're driving and you're a newly licensed driver, and then your parent is in the car with you, and you all are transporting two other non-relative friends, that, as I understand it, is a violation of your ability to drive at that point in time. So in other words, it doesn't matter that your parent is in the car with you. They may be required to be in the car with you if you just have learners, but you can't just haul all of your friends in the car and decide you're going to the mall and take your parent along and think that that covers it.
Texting became a primary law in the state of Virginia. What are the fines for that?
On a first offense for texting, it's $125. On a second or subsequent offense, it's $250 fine. Maybe more significantly, for minors, you are not supposed to be texting or using your cell phone at all in the car. Whether you're calling, texting, you should not be using it. And probably the biggest thing that's going to happen to you out of that is you could lose your license and not be able to get it back for significant periods of time.
And seatbelts. Seatbelts are very important. You have better than 50% chance of surviving a crash. And we know in this situation we had people ejected. Do you see or have a lot of cases where people were not wearing a seatbelt?
Well, I'm going to talk bad about the adults on the seatbelts, because I think there are more adults who say seatbelts are uncomfortable, or they don't fit right, or they just, that's, wasn't in the car when they were growing up, so why should they have to wear them? I think students have become more used to being, you know, strapped in from an early age in booster seats and then being expected to use seatbelts. You are an idiot if you don't use your seatbelt. I mean, that's the bottom line on it. And I hope that you all are smarter than that and take just that second and click it and make yourself safe. And, you know, keep the people who are in the car with you safe, too. You know, turn around and make sure. I mean, if you're driving the car, you're responsible for the behavior of the other people in that car. And they need to keep both you and everybody else on the road safe by not distracting you and by following the rules in your car, to include wearing a seatbelt.
Now if we could ask Deputy Hollingsworth, who is with the crash investigation team, just a couple of questions about what did you do and what was your purpose with the measurements and so on and so forth as we saw you working around the car.
In a fatality or a serious injury crash, we take a series of measurements and are able to plug those measurements into a equation and do math to figure out what the speed, approximate speed of the vehicle is. We usually do several different measurements from, as you saw, we measured from the vehicle where the passenger was launched to the fatal victim, and we can add those in to the math equation to figure out the approximate speed as well. If we're unable to locate any type of definite skid marks off the roadway or on the roadway, we can also download the vehicle black box, so to speak, the passenger control module. And that module will tell us who is seatbelted in the vehicle, whether or not the brakes were activated, if the accelerator was being pushed or if it had been released, a series of things such as headlights, signal lights, and things of that nature.
Okay, and then I'm assuming that what you have done, all the information that you've done, would be critical to the final outcome of this crash today. Charges, the court proceedings, Commonwealth attorney, and ultimately the judge.
Yes, we work hand in hand with the investigating lead deputy or officer. We provide the information that we find to that deputy, and we join in with them talking with Commonwealth's attorney and using that information to determine a type of charge that would be charged against the driver of the vehicle. In addition to that, we can supply witnesses. We not only re-interview everybody that might be a witness, a lot of times an initial deputy who interviews a witness will not get the same information that we do. So we will provide some witness information as well. We work hand in hand, and the case that the Commonwealth's attorney spoke of recently down in Luster's Gate in Blacksburg, we worked hand in hand in that investigation and was able to provide valuable information for that case. So not only are we providing the information for the initial investigating officer, but for long term as well. And in addition to criminal prosecution, we can be subpoenaed for civil cases as well.
We appreciate that. And I think now Deputy Underwood has some closing remarks.
I want to say thanks for you guys coming out here and listening to what we have going on. Social media, I don't know if you realize at the end, because things are a little scattered out here with what was going on, and you couldn't keep your attention to what you need to look at different things. Daisha Mance came running down here with Scarlett's mom, who is actually Miss Kay, but she's just betraying it. And it's kind of with acting. The good thing is, this is all just an act, but the sad part is, we see it every day, and it needs to stop. There's no need for us to have to come to crashes because people aren't paying attention and they're on the phone. Now back to the social media part, Daisha came down here because somebody texted her or Snapchatted and sent her a picture. That's not the best way that you want to remember how your friend was killed. You want to remember how they lived. Now that vision is always stuck in her mind. And it's out there for anybody to see. Is that how you want to be remembered? I know your parents don't, and there's a big debate about it in court right now with social media and how it's affecting how we do our job and how we can notify people properly. And also, if you're notifying people, she might have got the wrong information, might have got to the wrong parent, and they came to the scene and it wasn't their child. How do you think those people handle it? And the people we haven't got a chance to talk to give them the right notification because we're trying to get the other ones to go where they need to. So you guys really, really need to think what you post. You have brains, we just need to use them. You also need to encourage your parents to help you out too. There's gonna be a lot of things coming and going for you guys quickly. You need to remember, when you get behind that wheel, you're responsible for everything. And this is just as deadly as my gun. It only takes 2 seconds. It only takes 2 seconds to buckle. People won't do it. You tell me why. We really appreciate everybody who came out here to support. This is people that care about you. When you think nobody else does, there's still people here that do. So take your time, keep us in mind, and put your phones down. We want to see everybody in having a good time at prom. You guys can dance, do what you do, but if you get any accidents, there's no more dances for anybody. I do not like going to funerals, and I know you guys don't either. So try to remind your peers, your family, anybody you know, put those phones down. I want to thank you guys for coming out here, and I want you to have a good, safe prom. And graduation's coming, I want to see you walk across that stage. Mr. Vane, would you like to say a few words?
Yeah, thank you very much. My first comments are to all the volunteers that came out today. We greatly appreciate all of your time and all of your efforts, from Lifeguard 1 to funeral home, to deputy sheriffs, to the Commonwealth attorney. Thank you guys so much. My next comments are to the students. These people are here because they care deeply about you and they're affected by what happens to you.
It just doesn't happen to you, it happens to the whole community, represented by everyone here. So please remember that you're not alone, and your lives are affect so many of us. All right, right now what we're gonna do is that we're gonna open up the field so you can come and take a look at Lifeguard One, and you can take a look at the vehicles and so forth. And I'll give a call back in about 15 minutes to head back to class. But once again, if you would, students, let's give a thanks and a round of applause for everybody who like came out to help us tonight. All right, at about 2:15, I'll be giving you guys the call to go back to class. If you just either hang out here on the stadium or down the field, and I'll let you know when we're going back. Thank you.